finish out, because I used to do a little bit. We're still missing some, so let's keep them in prayer, going through the COVID thing and other things. But, you know, we want to lift them up today and pray for them as always. And we're going to do things a little different today. We're going to start out with a worship video and end with a worship video. But we want to open in prayer. Any pressing prayers? People need encouragement and lift it up in our body.
Barb just needs continuing prayer for sleep.
Yes.
She slept pretty good
always.
Last night.
I slept last night.
Not every other night.
And Sue's son needs lifted up in prayer. Mm-hmm. Dwayne. And Steve needs lifted up in prayer. And you know that old enemy, he likes to come in and gets down, doesn't he? Yeah. You have to put him out of your head.
Thank you, Jesus.
So let's open in prayer. And then Mike, we'll have a worship video after that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord.
Father God, we just come before you, Lord, so thankful to be in your house, so thankful to be in your arms, under your wings of protection. And Father God, we just ask that you would heal our nation. Mm-hmm. And disperse, yes, this COVID, Lord. Yes. Let it be gone.
In the name of Jesus.
And Lord, we continually ask for your forgiveness and cry out to you. Mm-hmm. And know and trust that you're our God, no matter what is going on in our life. We trust you, Lord, and you love us.
Thank you, Lord.
And we're so thankful for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, let's stand and give the Lord praise today. Yes.
Let's press it one more time. It should start.
Thank you. praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hearts.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, Lord, that our heart is wicked above all else, and yet you redeem it in Christ, Lord.
Yes.
And we thank you that you know the ways of the heart, that you know
yes.
the ways, Lord, to guide our heart, that you
thank
know
you,
the
Jesus.
Ways to guide us out of that wickedness
Praise
and into righteousness. You know the ways
Praise
to protect
Jesus.
Us, Lord, from things we know not. You know the ways, Lord, to show us the way. You are the way, you are the truth, you are the life, Lord Jesus.
Thank you. sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony in my ears. Like holy water on my fingers. Like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony in my ears. Like holy
a group of elders from another church that we went to anointed me with 6 quarts of oil. And it brought life into my body that never stopped. And I just praise God for that memory. And I just praise God for his anointing.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Praise Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
This last song, I'm going to maybe sing myself, and feel free, please, to join in. I felt like we needed to have a time of prayer today, being able to receive prayer. So Pastor Roxanne is going to walk around and bless you all in prayer today, if you would like that. If you don't want it, give her some kind of indication.
Steve, I'd like for you. Well, everybody, please, feel free to come, raise your hand.
Thank you.
Thank you.
this week, and the Lord brought it back to my attention this morning. And I was thinking about when you build a house or when you build a building of any kind. And I'm not a builder. I watch a lot of HGTV, but that doesn't make me anything except somebody that likes to watch TV. But when you build a building, first thing you do is you set the cornerstone. And we know that the cornerstone is Jesus Christ. And I don't know if this is true or this is just something that the Lord has impressed upon my heart. But as the Lord starts laying stones in our lives, He first builds that foundation. And then He puts on another layer and another layer and another layer. And you know, not all those stones are going to fit. But He has picked out the stone He wants to use. He picks out the perfect stone for that place. Mm-hmm. But there's a problem. There's a little teeny knot in that stone that He has to do something with, or it's going to rock. It's not going to fit right. And sometimes He has to chisel away at us a little bit because we got that little space that keeps showing up and causing us to be unstable and causing us to question everything that God tells us to do and causes us to question everything everybody else does. And when the enemy is doing that, trying to get us to question, guess what? We've lost a little bit of faith in the Lord and what He can do. And He says here in Ephesians 6, and I'm gonna read it starting in 14, but the one I want you to concentrate on is 16. Then we will no longer be infants tossed about by the waves and carried around by every wind of teaching and by the clever cunning of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into Christ Himself, who is the head. From Him, the whole body, fitted and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love through the work of each individual part. I want you to know that if I don't have this part of my side, I'm going to walk funny. If I don't have a kneecap, one leg is going to be shorter than the other. We need each other, all of us. Amen. We are all important. Yes, we are all a part of the body of Christ. Amen. And granted, this is one part of the whole body of Christ, but even in this body, we should be complete. And when God comes along and He starts nipping away at that little rough spot in us that needs to be taken care of, we need to let Him and not fight Him and not try to find a reason for Him to stop it. Just go with the flow and let God smooth up the rough spots in your life and help you to fit together into the body so that we all flow in the movement that Christ wants us to flow into. Because at some point, He's going to start bringing a lot more people. And when He does, we better have a firm foundation.
Yeah.
Because when those people come, they're going to bring with them the snakes.
Yes, they are.
And so we need to let God
let go,
whittle away. And I give Him permission this morning to whittle away at my spirit and take away those things that so desperately need to be taken care of.
I love your analogy out of that. How you use the rock. Reminds me of the skit guys. I don't know if any of you guys have seen the skit guys. What do they call them? But they do this skit where this guy has accepted Christ and he has all these areas in his life. And the other guy comes in with a big chisel, starts to chisel away. And I love how they do it. And it's painful. It's painful when that happens. And you're shown who you really are. And, you know, it's sometimes not pleasant.
I know when know, when something in my physical is, needs to be taken care of and I try to get rid of it, it hurts.
Yeah.
And I just wanna say, stop it, quit it, don't do it. I think about Roxanne and how she helps me with the little place on my back. You know, I wanna scream, stop it, don't do that. But at the same time, she's helping me with the poison in my body.
She does tell her husband to do that, so quit.
I do tell him that.
Why didn't you call your friend that would do it for you?
So anyway, it's just, you know, but I really feel like the Lord gave me that picture of I was thinking of cement blocks and how,
yeah,
you know, they sent a cement block.
And if they're off balance, too.
Yeah, they're off balance. They're made to interlock, but if you don't set them right, they're not going to lock.
That was from the Lord, I do believe. Anyway, we're going to be in 1 Samuel 19 today. Don't know what you're going to get, but I'm going to read the whole chapter. We'll go from there. Now Saul told Jonathan, I think I better turn my mic on. Steve, did you want prayer? Did I skip you? No, we're going to pray for you after service. We can come up and I'll pray for you. You're not okay. See it in your eyes. You got a problem you're dealing with.
We are praying for him right now, Pastor.
Yeah, get up here. Oh, my goodness. A lot of men have the same problem.
Statement in there where the bride says, I'm dark and unlovely and I'm not worthy,
Jesus.
And I'm needy.
Jesus.
And that's a true statement, the needy part.
Thank you, Lord.
The very next needy. Statement, the very next
praise
statement,
Jesus.
What you say is you say to the bride,
Jesus.
You are lovely in my eyes. You don't even address the unworthy part. You say, hey, I love you. I just declare right now the holy love of the Father,
yes,
upon
Jesus.
Steve.
Yes.
I declare the holy love of the Father upon Steve, that he is wanted by the Father, by the Holy Spirit, by Jesus. He is desired.
Yes, he is, Lord.
He is loved, he is treasured, he is valued. I thank you, Lord, that your blood does have the power that it says it has in your word to cover all sin. That if we confess our sins, you are
yes.
faithful and
yes.
just to forgive us
yes.
our sins, to
thank
cleanse
you.
Us from all unrighteousness. Lord God, we declare your forgiveness upon Steve. We
thank
declare
you,
your cleansing righteousness upon Steve.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
We thank you that Lord
yes, Jesus
is in the light, that he is in the light, that you are in the light. And so
thank
we
you,
can
Lord.
Have fellowship with you.
Thank
your
you,
people,
Lord.
Thank
Jesus.
You. You have made a way, a holy way
Jesus.
By which we are able to enter the throne room and the tabernacle, Lord. And you have made that way by your blood. It is open. Available.
Thank you, Jesus.
Your blood is the only way we have access.
Yes, Lord.
Not our claims to worthiness, not our claims to righteousness, and not even our claims to unworthiness can keep us from this place, Lord. And thank you that you have made that way open. It remains open for us, Lord. So I just pray, Lord,
thank you, Jesus.
Upon Steve.
Praise you, Jesus.
Praise the Father's heart upon Steve.
Lord.
Thank you that you are one of many sons that he came and died for. That you are one of many sons that he carries in the bosom of his heart. That your blood covers the
blood.
Thank you, Lord, that your perfect blood casts out the fear to create a perfect love of the Father right now to cast out
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus.
fear in your name. And Lord, if it does come back, thank you that your word says again and again, and don't be afraid. Come, come.
Praise you, Lord.
It doesn't say, don't be afraid, shame on you. It says, don't be afraid. Come on, come on, I want you.
Praise you, Jesus.
So I just pray that desire upon you.
Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Steve, one of the things I learned came out.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I believe God showed me something. It was a little bit, shocked.
I know we all have our problems with our loved ones, you know.
Yeah.
And Dennis and I got into it pretty sad the other day.
Yeah.
I know we all got that problem. Business now, it's all dumped back on my shoulders again, and then I got kind of into it with him, and we got Neil, and he needs a lot of prayer. I know all our kids need a lot of prayer, but
you need a lot of prayer too.
Yeah, but
you shouldn't have to be dealing with
it. But that's been heavy on my heart today.
God does.
Yeah, I know.
Hallelujah. Bart, put Steve on your prayer list.
Sure.
Both Steves.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm reading the whole chapter, 19, 1 Samuel 19. Now Saul told Jonathan, his son, and all his servants to put David to death. But Jonathan, Saul's son, greatly delighted in David. So Jonathan told David, saying, Saul, my father, is seeking to put you to death. Now therefore, please be on guard in the morning and stay in a secret place and hide yourself. I will go out and stand beside my father in the field where you are, and I will speak with my father about you. If I find out anything, then I will tell you. Then Jonathan spoke well of David and Saul, his father, and said to him, Do not let the king sin against his servant David, since he has been very beneficial to you. For he took his life in his hand and struck the Philistine. And the Lord brought about a great deliverance for all Israel. You saw it and rejoiced. Why then will you sin against innocent blood by putting David to death without a cause? Saul listened to the voice of Jonathan, and Saul vowed, As the Lord lives, he shall not be put to death. Then Jonathan called David, and Jonathan told him all these words. And Jonathan brought David to Saul, and he was in his presence as formerly he was. When there was a war again, David went out and fought with the Philistines and defeated them with great slaughter, so that they fled before him. Now there was an evil spirit from the Lord on Saul as he was sitting in his house with a spear in his hand. And David was playing the harp with his hand, and Saul tried to pin David to the wall with a spear, but he slipped away out of Saul's presence so that he struck the spear into the wall, and David fled and escaped that night. Then Saul sent messengers to David's house to watch him in order to put him to death in the morning. But Michal, David's wife, told him, saying, "If you do not save your life tonight, tomorrow you will be put to death." So Michal let David down through a window, and he went out and fled and escaped. Now Michal took the household idol and laid it on the bed, and put a quilt of goat's hair at his head, and covered it with clothes. And when Saul sent messengers to take David, she said, "He's sick." Then Saul sent messengers to see David, saying, "Bring him up to me on his bed, that I may put him to death." When the messengers entered, behold, the household idol was on the bed with the quilt of goat's hair at its head. So Saul said to Michal, "Why have you deceived me like this and let my enemy go so that he has escaped?" And Michal said to Saul, "He said to me, 'Let me go. Why should I put you to death?'" Now David fled and escaped and came to Samuel at Ramah and told him all that Saul had done to him. And he and Samuel went and stayed in Naoth. It was told that Saul, saying, "Behold, David is at Naoth in Ramah." Then Saul sent messengers to take David, but when they saw the company of prophets prophesying with Samuel standing beside him over them, the Spirit of God came upon the messengers of Saul, and they also prophesied. When it was told Saul, he sent other messengers, and they also prophesied. So Saul sent messengers again the third time, and they also prophesied. Then he himself went to Ramah and came as far as a large well that is in Sekah, and he asked and said, "Where are Samuel and David?" And someone said, "Behold, they are at Naoth in Ramah." He proceeded there to Naoth in Ramah, and the Spirit of God came upon him also, so that he went along prophesying continually until he came to Naoth in Ramah. He also stripped off his clothes, and he too prophesied before Samuel and lay down naked all that day and all that night. Therefore, they say, "Is Saul also among the prophets?" A lot going on here. Now, Jonathan and David had a very close relationship. They trusted one another. They believed in one another. They lifted each other up. And when Saul was coming against David, Jonathan went in to talk to his dad. "Dad, you can't come against David. Look what all he's done. Look, he's went into battle for you and killed the Philistines. He cut off the head of Jonathan, and because of that, you've been blessed. Because of that, he brings blessing, because God is with him." So then, he's listening to the sweet, sweet music of David. Sweet, sweet sound of his voice. So I imagine he was singing as he was playing. And he's getting mad. He's tossing that spear back and forth. And he's getting upset. Because, see, David's blessed. And he wants that same kind of close relationship that David has with God. He wants that back. But he's the one that let it go.
That's right.
He's the one that chose to let it go. Mm-hmm. He was full of himself, you see. He couldn't see because he had blinded eyes. Like having a blindfold on. Can't see the truth. You know, Saul was always making excuses. So he hurls that spear toward David. I don't know. Was David sitting playing the harp? Was he standing up playing the harp? Was he walking back and forth singing? I don't know. But he hurled that spear at him. David had no idea he was going to be stabbed in the back, so to speak, or stabbed in the front, so to speak. He had no idea because Jonathan had talked to his father, and his father said, oh, okay, we can't kill him. He had no idea, so he was shocked by this whole thing. Shocked. And he thought, that's it. He's already hurled that thing at me 3 times now. That's it. I'm gone. I'm gone. What's that old saying? Three strikes and you're out. Three strikes and he was out the door. So he escapes. Michael helps him, his wife. Lets him down on the window. Now, one thing I found really interesting in this is that Michael put the idol in the bed.
Yeah.
Covered him with goat's hair. This tells us that not all idols are small, because that idol would have had to been pretty big to be laying in the bed to make it look like there was a person laying there. Mm-hmm. So it had to be kind of a good size, right? And the fact that she even had this idol in the house kind of blows me away, because David's a man of God. So she had to have had it somewhere, unbeknownst, don't you think? So David goes into the caves. Now here they go. Saul sends out messengers. He sends out people to come against him, right? Come against him. That for us, that could be, mm-hmm. What is that? Mouths wagging. Mm-hmm. Gossiping going on. Division, you know. Our mouth causes division. Anyway, he sends messengers after. Now, God is protecting him.
Yes, he is.
God is protecting David, because every time they get close to him where they can kill him, guess what happens? Woo! Glory. The Holy Ghost comes down. The Holy Ghost falls on all of them. And they start prophesying. I want you to know, if you've ever been under the anointing of the Holy Ghost and it's on you heavy, you're going down. You're going down. It's been on me like that. And I went down. I just kind of slid down the wall to my knees. God can put you on your knees. I don't care who you think you are or how spiritual you think you are. God can put you on your knees.
Yes, he can.
Well, now, they start prophesying. They can't do nothing. When the Holy Ghost's on them, they can't do nothing. It's like they're, you ever been drunk and you just can't stand up right? Can't speak right because you're drunk? I imagine this is what they were feeling. Sends more out. Guess what? They get close and they start prophesying. Following them. This prophesying back, they had a school of prophets in the old days.
Yeah.
They had a school of prophets. And it taught them how to hear the anointing, how to hear God's voice and how to speak it out. So here comes the second round of messengers after David. People who have gotten together. Yeah, let's go out and kill him. Saul wants us to, so let's obey. So they're going after David. Falls on them again, and they start prophesying. And Saul says, I'll just do it myself. Sometimes that happens in leadership. Sometimes that happens. You got to come in, clean the toilets, and do the dishes, sweep the floors. You know, leadership starts with
serving.
Mm-hmm. Serving. You do what needs to be done.
Yeah.
And sometimes you put other people in head to do that. And they don't get it done. So then you got to come back in and do it yourself.
Yep.
There's a follow through that happens. Well, Saul's like, well, I don't know what they're doing. They're not back. So I got to go take care of this mess myself. I got to go kill him. He gets down there. The Spirit of God comes on him too, and he starts prophesying. And guess what? He not only starts prophesying, he strips down naked. Mm-hmm. And God lays him out.
Yep.
Did you notice that? And he laid down, Scripture says. God put him flat on his face. And would not let that power come up from him because he was protecting David. Now let me tell you, there's a lot going on in the world today. There's a lot of people discouraged because of the prophets and what the prophets had said about Trump being still president and leading into another term. A lot of people are talking about the prophets now. Can't believe them anymore. I want to tell you something. Prophets make mistakes too. You want to know what happens? God gives them a word. They start running with it. They start getting excited with their own emotions. And then they start adding because it's what they perceive and they want. They think that's what God is saying. So then they put it out. So then everybody now say, oh, they're a false prophet. They're a false prophet. No, they're not. No, they're not. You want to know why? How do you learn? By making mistakes. Right?
Yeah.
That's how you learn. That's how you grow. Next time they say something, you better bet they're going to make sure that they don't let their own emotions get in there. That they don't let their own feelings get in there. Mm-hmm. That they speak the word of God. Can you imagine how they're all feeling right now? I think they need lifted up in prayer, don't you? Because mm-hmm. I imagine that would be hard. When God shows you something and you want to speak it out, you always go, is that you, God, or is that me? Is that you, God, or is that me? Because, see, we have our own physical emotions and the spirit warring like this, back and forth. Because we want to make sure that we're connecting with God and not with our flesh. I was down a little bit. I was down a little bit. And I don't believe that all this stuff is over yet. I really don't. I don't care if he's president. I don't believe it's over yet. I believe God's still got a plan. And I want to know, who you going to trust? You going to trust God? Are you going to trust what it looks like in the world? Because we all know what it looks like in the world is not what the spiritual world is. Yeah. Y'all are blank.
I agree.
We've got to get out of ourselves. We've got to get out of putting trust in a man. Now, I wanted Donald Trump to win. But, you know, too many people were looking to Trump instead of looking to God.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
And we can do, and you know what? Saul gets caught up in trying to do his own thing and not looking to God. And who did David look to? He looked to God for the answer. He looked to God to give him songs to play. Every worship leader loves songs. Because Psalms is got a lot of worship songs in it. And a lot of worship leaders sing the Psalms. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with that. A lot of worship directors or leaders, whatever you want to call them, they have a way of writing their own songs. That's a beautiful thing. Sing a new song to the Lord. Isn't that what Scripture says?
Yeah.
Sing a new song to God. Know how we're going about our day, doing dishes, whatever. I love you, Jesus. I praise your name. Y'all see me going through the house. Sometimes you just need to sing out stuff to encourage yourself.
Yes. Yeah. Amen.
We can be in a place where we just let the enemy shoot an arrow here, shoot an arrow there, shoot an arrow here, everywhere at us. And then we're like, oh, I don't know what happened, God. I don't understand all this going on. Who are you trusting? What's happening out here? And what's happening up there? You know, when God was leading me to start the home and the church here, he was giving me things, and I walked with him step by step. Everything doesn't happen all at once. It's by little, tiny, baby steps. And that's how you can grow in your relationship with God. Little, tiny, baby steps. But you know what? You don't win the battle until you start stepping out. You don't win the battle until you start putting into actions things that God has given you to do. And if you want a closer relationship with God, if you want that, get up an hour earlier. Open up a devotional book or the Bible. Pray. Make a commitment with God. It's a date. Know how you have a date? You're going to go out with somebody. You take a shower. You put on your makeup. You try on like four or five outfits. I know women do. I don't know about men, but women try on outfits. How do I look in this? Do I look too fat? Okay. We try to look our best for our date. Are you looking your best for God? Are you looking your best for God? Are you putting in the things that you need to do to be committed to that relationship? Because if you are, you ought to be full of the Holy Spirit. You ought to be full of Christ. You ought to be in a place where you got the power, you got the armor on, and every time he shoots a thing of division between a relationship, a family, you whip out that sword and you start cutting that enemy's head off. Because I want to tell you, family is so very important.
It is.
And when you've been crushed and hurt by someone who made promises, Steve's dealing with the situation, but I can relate. it hurts because you love. You love that other person. And you don't want that division. You want God to come in and heal it. And I don't know what the answer is. I really don't. But God does. Put your trust in him that he's going to work it out, that he's going to show you the way, that he's going to lead you where you need to be. Because that's what David did. Mm-hmm. He knew when that spear came at him that he was going to leave. He was going to run. That's it. Three strikes. Now I'm gone. He knew. He also knew he could trust God, because no matter how many men Saul sent to him, he was protected. Was he not? Mm-hmm. Any of you in fear today because of what's going on in the world, COVID? Or maybe we can see the bomb beginning to happen, and we can see taxes going up, and we can see all kinds of things happening now. All the border, you know, people coming, just flooding into our land and taking our jobs from us. And I mean, we can see all that happening. What's the future look like? Well, if you look at all that, it doesn't look very good. And I want to tell you right now, it never says in the Bible things are going to get better. But that doesn't mean us. We are children of God. God will always protect us. God will always fulfill his promise in our life for us because we follow him. We don't follow man, or we're not supposed to be following man. We follow God. I know if chaos starts happening, people start coming in to this land and breaking windows and everything else and shooting people and stuff like that, God has got us under his wing.
Thank you, Lord.
He protects us. He knows your heart. He knows your heart. And he loves each and every one of you. Mm-hmm. Each and every one. He knows how you feel. He knows if you feel failure. He knows if you're discouraged.
He knows if you feel like nobody loves you. He knows if you feel like I've been stabbed in the back. He knows if you feel like you're just so depressed, you feel like you want to take your own life because there's nothing else to live for. He knows all of it. He knows all of it. But I can tell you what, if you put him first in your life, I mean put him first. When you get up in the morning and you're drinking your coffee or tea or Mountain Dew, whatever you drink, put God first. Go to him in prayer. Then put a worship song on. Open your Bible. You know what? I used to not like it when people just open their Bible and read the scripture. And, oh, thank you, God. You gave that to me today. I used to think there had to be like a focused place you went to. But sometimes I want to tell you, you just open your Bible and your eyes fall upon a scripture, and that might be the very scripture that you need for that day. Like this whole last week, God was giving me Jeremiah 29:11. And I'm like, Lord, is that for me? Somebody in the church? Who's that for? Everybody. Everybody. That's what you get back. But I believe there's a few here today that God wanted that to be for you. He has a purpose and a plan for your life. And if you feel like it hasn't went the way that you thought it was going to go, guess what? He knows. Mm-hmm. He's got a purpose and a plan for your life, and you're not done yet.
Right.
You are not done yet. Do you think David, as he was running, felt like, I'm done. Man, he's after me. He's going to get me. He's going to kill me. He's going to take everything away from me. Did David have a lot? No, he didn't. He didn't have a lot. Remember, he didn't even have a dowry to pay for Michael. Mm-hmm. His dowry was supposed to be 100 foreskins of the Philistines, but he brought back 200. If you go to work for God, and I mean you put him first and you go to work for God, God is going to bless you. God is going to protect you. No matter what walk of life you're in, he's going to uphold you and he's going to keep you. And you might not know which way to turn sometimes in your life with situations that happen. But God is showing you the way. He's going to show you the way, Steve. He's going to show you the way, Steve. Two Steves. He's going to show you the way. He's going to show you the way, Bernice. He's going to show all of us the way. Uh-huh. Linda, he's going to show you the way.
Amen.
But when he shows you something, walk in it. Doesn't mean you're supposed to take off and run. No. Walk the path. Don't run the path. Walk it out. And when we get going down the wrong path sometimes, or we do something wrong, oh, get back on the right path. Own up to it.
Mm-hmm.
Own up to it. I have to confess I was discouraged in God over some things. I was discouraged. I'm like, God, that's not how it was supposed to go. But you know what? He knows.
Uh-huh.
I was discouraged with the prophet thing. But God knows. He's going to lead you and direct you. I think some of us too many times watch too much crap on videos. Not crap, but we watch too much stuff on videos that other people are preaching or prophesying, and we get caught up in it. It's like anything else. You get caught up in watching what you like to hear. But when we start looking to another person before we look to God, we got a problem. I don't want you all to look to me. Because guess what? I make mistakes. And guess what? My memory's not that great. My hearing's going now. I'll have to ask somebody two or three times what they said. You know, I know when I was dealing with elderly people and they couldn't hear very well when I was working for Pathfinders. It gets aggravating. I know that. So I understand people when they get aggravated with me. I know, because I know me. I know how I am. So does God. He still loves me.
Yeah.
Right? He still loves you.
can't give up. You gotta get, keep fighting. Okay, we got a little time. Let's share. What did you, sheep, or I don't know, what'd you get out of this message? Keep fighting? Keep going? Painful when somebody turns on you? How Saul turned on David? The pain? You know, if you're in a family and you have things like that happen, it hurts. Anybody?
I've been so discouraged over the prophet thing, and I mean, I was really pouring a lot of prayer and intercession into President Trump being reelected, and you know, he wasn't my God. It wasn't that I was looking to him, but he was trying to help America be America.
Yes.
Amen.
And
yes, well put.
And so when he didn't win, and I know that it's not over, but I don't think he's going to get back into office, at least not for 4 years. And I got really discouraged about it, and I think I got a little mad at God, and I confessed to God, and to y'all, I got a little aggravated at him, because I wanted him, God to do what I wanted God to do.
Yeah.
And God's ways are not my ways.
Amen.
And I just... you know, I'm sorry that I got mad at God, and I repent for that. And I'm sorry that I put too much stock in a man.
And you're forgiven.
You know, there's nothing wrong with us having trust in our brother, but we also have to understand that our brothers are human.
Yes.
And they make mistakes, and they say and do stupid things, and they hurt us. And we hurt them.
Amen.
And we just have to we have to let God help us to pull ourselves up from by the bootstraps and go on. We can't do it by ourselves. We have to do it with the Lord. But it's a hard lesson. And I don't care how long you've been walking with God. If you're not being taught a lesson, there's something wrong. Because we should constantly be maturing in Christ. It is not a once and done thing. We constantly are growing up in Him. And we should always be able to be teachable.
Yes.
So, but I know how discouraged I've been. I don't think my sleep issues have anything to do with that. I think there's actually something going on in my physical body. I just don't know what it is yet.
Thank you for that confession, Barb. You know, it's biblical. Confess thy sins one to another. Biblical. Anybody else get anything from
you? I think the prophets, instead of listening to God right at that time, they were listening to what they wanted God to do, and not what God told them to do or God is going to do. They wanted President Trump too.
We all did.
Yeah.
We all do, because we just don't want to lose the freedom America has.
Yeah.
And we are losing it. I mean, not even a little bit at the time right now. It's going down the tubes in a hurry.
No, they have to be a lot better in 2024 when people realize how bad it's going to get. And 80% of people that voted for Biden wasn't because they wanted Biden. They didn't want Trump. You know, the
that's
Democrat.
True.
Mm-hmm. So it could have been anybody. Ralph Nader years ago, he would have got president.
Yeah. I don't mean to offend anybody, but you remember we're live, so we don't want to get politics in there. We'll be getting a lot of hate stuff. Anybody else?
Well, I just feel that the Lord's in control.
Amen.
And whatever happens in this country is what He meant to have happen.
Yep.
And if it's what it takes to get us back in line, that's what it's going to be.
Yeah, Lord, pray that this is what we do need.
Yeah.
Just all need to keep our eyes on Jesus, no matter what.
That's correct. That's correct.
Things go wrong, keep your eyes on Jesus.
Yeah.
Things go good, keep your eyes on Jesus.
Amen. 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 Sometimes God allows bad things to happen to
get his people to really cry out to him. I mean, I know we were all crying out to God.
Maybe we have what we have now because God wants us back on our knees.
I think so.
Amen.
We'll be on our knees the next 4 years, that's for sure.
Yeah, be on our knees, crying out to him.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, Sister Roxanne, I guess I'm going to be different from what everybody else has said. I, like everybody else, I'm wanting Trump to win, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm still looking for that. I really am. I've not counted it out. I believe that the evil, and I pray God's scripture. I'm not just praying what the prophet said. I go by
evil.
Scripture. I said, Lord, you said if anybody blessed Israel, you would bless them.
Uh-huh.
If they curse Israel, you will curse them.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And Donald Trump blessed Israel.
Yes.
Yeah.
He was for life.
Amen.
The reason people hated Donald Trump, because he stood for life.
Uh-huh.
He stood for what God wanted. Now, Donald Trump wasn't a holy, godly man. We all know that, and I doubt if most of us as holy as we think we are.
That's right.
I'm still looking for this to turn out.
Yeah.
I'm not turning my
right
own prophets.
Yeah,
because some of them may have been prophesying because somebody else prophesied.
Yeah.
But I'm going by what the Word of God says.
Amen.
When it come about the 20th, I started thinking, Donald Trump's not going to get that. I just began to believe that Biden would take it on the 20th.
Mm-hmm.
But I believe it still will be straightened out. And I may be proven wrong, but
I
don't think so. I'm looking to God to straighten this mess out. And had he done it the way we all wanted it to, all this filth and corrupt stuff that's going on in the Senate and these high places would still be hid. I watch that stuff a lot. I know I'm taking a lot of time. I watch that stuff a lot on TV. They get up there and they fuss and complain and barge one another. And you think something's going to come of this.
Yeah.
But then when the TV goes on, you never hear of it. It's all right. It's swept back under the rug.
Uh-huh.
All the stuff they do wrong swept back under the rug and this and that. And, you know, that's not God's way. God said if righteousness reigns.
Yep.
And I believe, and that's what I pray, God, let your righteousness reign. Tear down the evil. Send out Michael and the angels to
He's
fight
doing
this
it
evil
his way.
And
God's
bring it in, you know. We'll never be blessed if we don't stand up and look to God, as they'll say.
Amen.
We got to look to God. And even though it looks like it's over, it's not over. I don't, when I look on TV and see all that Biden's already put back, and I think, my God, how can anybody stand for something like that?
Mm-hmm.
But they're blinded.
And
they've been blinded by the God of this world, which is the devil.
Yeah.
But we've got a higher power, and his name is Jesus. And I believe in him to move and tear down this filth and corruption.
Amen.
And Biden even went to church.
Huh?
And Biden even went to church then.
Yeah.
He's a devout Catholic, they say, but
yeah.
Catholics don't want to kill babies.
That's where I was with it, though.
Yeah. You know, for me, it's life all the way. I believe in, I'm pro-life. And,
thank you, Jesus.
And
one thing I heard is that they're going to turn their back on Israel and start wanting a two-state.
Yeah, I saw that too.
And I
that
hadn't even thought about that. They're already talking about it. And we won't be honored if we turn our back.
No, but I still believe God's going to get in the way. So
God's in control.
He's in control. He's more powerful than any man. And I don't care what they think they're going to do. God has what he's going to do. And he'll accomplish it through non-believers if he has to.
Amen.
He'll accomplish it.
Yeah.
Never, if he can take Saul and lay Saul on his back, he can lay anybody out.
That's right.
So when it's his time to move, he will move.
That's right.
We're going to close in prayer. Anybody else have anything they want to say?
I appreciate you, Pastor.
I appreciate you all, too. Love y'all. Let's close in prayer. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for this word. We thank you for the message, Lord, that you brought forth. Father, we thank you for each and every one here, Lord, and we ask that you would put your hand on them, Lord, and your face would shine upon them, Lord God, that you'd go into their homes and their families and their jobs, Lord, and glorify them, lift them up, Lord, encourage them,
yes.
Increase their property. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, guys. God bless you.
Love y'all. Bless you.
Have a good one, Linda.
Hey, thank you.